torque equation. A turning or twisting moment of force about an axis is called torque. Let us consider a wheel with radius of capital R, acting upon by a circumferential force F newtons as shown in figure. So now the wheel is rotating with a speed of nrpm, capital nrpm, revolutions per minute. Now, so this is in normal rpm, that is now that will be converted into angular speed. So the wheel is rotating with its normal speed of nrpm. Now this speed must be converted into angular speed, that is nothing but omega. Omega is equal to 2 pi n by 60 radians per second. So now calculate the work done. Work done in one revolution is equal to force into distance. Distance is nothing but distance traveled in one revolution. So F into distance is nothing but, so what is the circumference of this circle? 2 pi r. So work done is equal to force into distance, that is F into 2 pi r joules. And we know that power is nothing but work done by time. So power developed is work done by time. So therefore work done is nothing but F into 2 pi r by time. Time for one revolution, that is 60 by n, right? So now F into r, 2 pi n is uppercase, so F into r and 2 pi n by 60. What is this 2 pi n by 60? Angular speed, omega. And what is the, so F into r, force into radius is nothing but torque, twisting moment of force about an axis. Axis is nothing but radius. So F into r is nothing but torque, 2 pi n by 60 is nothing but angular speed. So power developed is equal to product of torque and angular speed, watts. And we know that power in armature means the power developed in armature. Armature EMF is EB, armature current is IA. So power developed in armature is nothing but product of EB into IA. So EB into IA. Now both powers are equal, that means, so power in armature is equal to armature torque multiplied by angular speed. So power in armature is nothing but EB into IA. Power in the sense power developed, this is value. So this is equation 1, and the P is equal to T into omega, put as equation 1, and P is equal to EB into IA, equation 2. Now both are equal to each other. EB into IA is equal to TA into 2 pi n by 60. But we know that EB, back EMF, pi z n by 60 into P by A. Put that equation in this equation. So pi z n by 60 into P by A into IA, TA 2 pi n by 60. 60 cancel, n cancel. Therefore TA is equal to 1 by 2 pi, pi IA, pi z IA into P by A. So what is the value of 1 by 2 pi? 0.159. So armature torque 0.159 pi z IA into P by A newton meter. This is the most important. 1 by 2 pi pi z IA into P by A, otherwise 0.159 pi z IA into P by A newton meter. This is the armature torque. Generally torques are, three types of torques available: shaft torque, last torque, armature torque, right? So look at the figure. So the torque developed in the armature is called armature torque or gross torque. And torque developed at the load, so that is called shaft torque or useful torque. So in between load and armature, some torque may be lost. That torque is called lost torque. Therefore, armature torque, developed torque, is equal to shaft torque plus lost torque. TA is equal to TF plus TSH. So net output of the motor is nothing but shaft torque multiplied by omega, that is angular speed 2 pi n by 60. Generally rating of the motor, generally we are taking HP, horse powers, 1 HP, 2 HP, 3 HP, like that. So this is the maximum power developed condition in DC motor. So this equation is under back EMF. Back EMF equation is nothing but IA is equal to EB, V minus EB by RA. From that, V is equal to EB plus IA RA. So we are getting power. Power is nothing but product of voltage and current. That's why multiplying armature current both sides of the above equation. So V into IA, EB into IA, IA square RA. So V into IA, EB into IA plus IA square RA. Now, so that one, V into IA, electrical input to the armature, EB into IA, that is electrical equivalent of mechanical power developed in the armature, IA square RA, copper losses in the armature. Now, gross mechanical power developed. So total electrical power, V into IA minus losses, that is nothing but mechanical power developed, V into IA minus IA square RA. So to getting the maximum power, so maximum power is nothing but differentiate the power equation with respect to IA. So PM is equal to VIA minus IA square RA. Now differentiating this equation with respect to IA. So dPM by dIA is equal to V 2IA RA equal to 0. So from this, IA RA is equal to V by 2. The condition is IA RA is equal to V by 2. Substitute this one into above equation. So V is equal to EB plus IA RA. In place of IA RA, put V by 2. So V is equal to EB plus V by 2. Therefore, EB is equal to V by 2. So this is the maximum power condition. Maximum efficiency of a DC motor occurs when back EMF is equal to half of the applied voltage. So maximum efficiency of a DC motor occurs when back EMF EB is equal to half of the applied voltage. So this is the DC motor practically.
You can find DC motors in many portable home appliances, automobiles, and types of industrial equipment.
Look at the DC motor.
In this video, we will logically understand the operation and construction of a commercial DC motor. Let's first start with the simplest DC motor possible. It looks like this. The stator provides a constant magnetic field, and the armature, which is the rotating part, is a simple coil. The armature is connected to a DC power source through a pair of commutator rings. When the current flows through the coil, an electromagnetic force is induced on it according to the Lorentz law, so the coil will start to rotate. You will notice that as the coil rotates, the commutator rings connect with the power source of opposite polarity. As a result, on the left side of the coil, the electricity will always flow away, and on the right side, electricity will always flow towards. This ensures that the torque action is also in the same direction throughout the motion, so the coil will continue rotating. But if you observe the torque action on the coil closely, you will notice that when the coil is nearly perpendicular to the magnetic flux, the torque action nears zero. As a result, there will be irregular motion of the rotor if you run such a DC motor. Here is the trick to overcoming this problem. Add one more loop to the rotor, with a separate commutator pair for it. In this arrangement, when the first loop is in the vertical position, the second loop will be connected to the power source. So a motive force is always present in the system. Moreover, the more such loops, the smoother will be the motor rotation. In a practical motor, the armature loops are fitted inside slots of highly permeable steel layers. This will enhance magnetic flux interaction. Spring-loaded commutator brushes help to maintain contact with the power source. A permanent magnet stator pole is used only for very small DC motors. Most often, an electromagnet is used. The field coil of the electromagnet is powered from the same DC source. The field coils can be connected to the rotor windings in two different ways, parallel or series. The result is two different kinds of DC motor constructions, a shunt and a series motor. The series wound motor has good starting torque, but its speed drops drastically with the load. The shunt motor has a low starting torque, but it is able to run almost at a constant speed, irrespective of the load acting on the motor. Unlike the other electrical machines, DC motors exhibit a unique characteristic, the production of back EMF. A rotating loop in magnetic field will produce an EMF according to the principle of electromagnetic induction. The case of rotating armature loops is also the same. An internal EMF will be induced that opposes the applied input voltage. The back EMF reduces armature current by a large amount. Back EMF is proportional to the speed of the rotor. At the starting of the motor, back EMF is too low, thus the armature current becomes too high, leading to the burnout of the rotor. Thus, a proper starting mechanism that controls the applied input voltage is necessary in large DC motors. One of the interesting variations of the DC motor is a universal motor, which is capable to run under both AC and DC power sources. To know more about it, please check the next video. Thank you.
That is about practical DC motor. Now go for the types of DC motors. Generally, types of DC motors or types of DC generators are both are same. Only the motor, the action of principle must be different for generator and motor. In generator, the armature current is always flowing through the load circuit, but motor, so the armature current is taken from the supply and it is flowing through the armature. So that is the only difference. As usual, depending upon the excitation, so motors are broadly classified into two types, separately excited and self-excited, same as DC generator. So for the in self-excited, again classified into DC shunt, series, compound. In compound, again DC long shunt and short shunt. So look at the figure. So only one difference, there is no diagrammatic change, same ditto as DC generators, but only one difference. In generators, here EMF is generated and armature current is flowing like this. But coming to the DC motor, we are giving the supply. That's why supply is taken, armature current is flowing like this. That is the difference between the generator and motor. Separately excited, so a separate field A separate field is excited with a separate source, and a separate field current is flowing IF like this. So for that, so we know the field current RF. RF is field resistance, EB is the back EMF. Power developed is nothing but EB into IA, and power developed in armature, EB into IA. Power input is nothing but VT into IL or IA. So this is V is equal to, so E plus IARA. So V is equal to E plus IARA, voltage equation. V is equal to E plus IARA. So look at the DC shunt motor and series motor. As usual, shunt motor is nothing but field winding is connected across the armature winding, and the combination is connected to the supply voltage, right? Let RSH is the shunt field resistance, RA is the armature winding resistance. Always RA be very small, but RSH is very high, right? 100 to 300. So large number of turns of thin wire, so that's why RSH is high. Therefore RSH is high means the shunt field current is less, right? And voltage current equations of IA, so IL will be like coming like this, IA is flowing and ISH is like this. Therefore IL is equal to IL is from the diagram, IL is equal to IA plus ISH. Load current is equal to armature current plus shunt current, and shunt current is nothing but V by RSH as usual. And voltage equation, V is equal to EB plus IARA, plus brush drop is also there. Next, power input. Input is nothing but voltage multiplied by load current IL. Power input is nothing but V into IL. Power developed is nothing but VB into IA. Coming to this series motor, a series field winding is connected in series with the armature and supply. So let RSE be the series field resistance and RA be the armature resistance. RA, RSE, both are very small. Why? Because RSE is made up of small turns of thick wire. From the diagram, IL is equal to ISE is equal to IA. Therefore, E is equal to V is equal to E plus IARA plus ISERSE. Input is nothing but V into IL. Armature power developed is EB into IA. Coming to the compound motor. Compound motor consists of a part of field winding connected in series and a part of field winding connected in parallel with armature. Therefore, it is further classified as long shunt compound and short shunt compound, right? Long shunt compound motor means, in long shunt compound, the shunt field winding is connected across the combination of armature and series field. Shunt field winding is connected combination of armature and series field. Let RSE be the resistance of series field, RSH is be the resistance of shunt field. Therefore the total current drawn from the supply is IL. So from the diagram, IL is equal to ISE plus ISH. But ISC, IA, both are same, right? So therefore IL is equal to IA plus ISH. And ISH is nothing but as usual V by RSH. So V is equal to EB plus IARA plus ISE RSE plus brush contact drop. Power input means V into IL, power developed is EB into IA. Coming to the short shunt compound generator motor, shunt field is connected purely in parallel with armature only, not in series field or combination. So shunt field is connected purely armature only. So and the series field is connected in series with the combination as shown in figure. From this diagram, IL is equal to ISE. Therefore, IL is equal to IA plus ISH. IL is equal to ISE and this is equal to IA plus ISH. From this, ISH is equal to V minus ISE RSE by RSH. As usual, V is equal to EB plus ISE RSE plus IARA plus brush drop. As usual, power developed EB into IA, power input V into IL. Compound, long shunt compound motor may be a of cumulative compound or differential compound or level compound. Similarly, short shunt compound motor can be cumulative or differential type. Cumulative means aiding series field plus shunt field, both are aiding. Resultant flux is more. Pi R is equal to pi SH plus pi SC. That is nothing but cumulative compound. More voltage will be produced. Whereas in differential compound is nothing but different. Resultant flux is nothing but difference between the shunt field and series field. So next very, very important topic. After this topic, I am stop this class. Characteristics of DC motors. Generally, to know about the performance of motor, so we can characterize motor parameters in different situations. Motor parameters is nothing but electrical parameters is there, mechanical parameters is there. Electrical parameter means armature current. Mechanical parameter means torque, speed, right? Now the characteristics, performance of DC motor under various conditions can be judged by the following characteristics. First one, torque versus armature current. All of you please listen clearly. Torque versus armature current, T versus IA. So this characteristics is drawn between torque and armature current, and this characteristic is also called as electrical characteristics. Why? Because electrical term is there, that's why you can call it as electrical characteristics. Another one, speed versus armature current. So the graph showing the relationship between the speed and armature current is called speed armature current characteristics, and this is also called as electrical characteristics. Why? Because term, electrical term is there. And last one, speed versus torque characteristics. The graph showing the relationship between the speed and torque of the motor is called speed torque characteristics of motor. These are also called as mechanical characteristics. Why? Because speed is mechanical term, torque is also mechanical term. That's why. So this characteristic is called mechanical characteristics. Above two characteristics, electrical characteristics, and this characteristic is called mechanical characteristics. Mainly, to analyze the above three characteristics, first of all, to know these two characteristics, torque proportional to pi IA, torque proportional to pi IA, n proportional to 1 by pi. Torque proportional to pi IA, already we derived the torque equation. T is equal to 0.159 pi z IA into p by a. Z to p a constants, 0.159 constants. Therefore, torque directly proportional to pi Ia. Another one, speed. From the back EMF equation, n proportional to Eb by pi. So by using these two relations, we can analyze these three characteristics. So first, for shunt motors, very, very important. So for each graph, 2 marks. So here, 3 graphs, 3 to 6 marks. Otherwise, 3 ones, 3 marks. First, characteristics of DC shunt motor, torque versus armature current. We know that for shunt motors, the flux is constant. So we know, so torque proportional to pi Ia, for pi is constant shunt motor, therefore torque proportional to Ia. Now, if current changes, armature current changes, torque also changes. That's why it is a straight line flowing from the origin. So torque versus armature current characteristics for DC shunt motor is a straight line. Right? This equation represents a straight line passing through the origin as shown in figure. As torque increases linearly with armature current, it seemed earlier that armature current is decided by the load. So as load increases, armature current also increases, increasing the torque developed linearly, right? So this is the armature current, but shaft torque. Now the shaft torque is plotted against armature current. It is known as shaft torque and it is shown in dotted lines. So this is the shaft torque is the nothing but always less than the armature torque. Shaft torque is always less than the armature torque. That's why I am putting here. On no load condition, TSH is zero, but armature torque is present, which is just enough to overcome the stray losses as shown in figure. Right? Next one, speed versus armature current. We know that n proportional to Eb by pi. So for shunt motor, flux is constant, therefore n proportional to Eb, V minus Ia Ra. So the speed decreases with increasing drop, right? So it may be a drop may be decreases only 5 to 15%. Therefore, shunt motor is a constant speed motor. So the speed may reduced small amount only. That means suppose for rated speed and it will be reduced somewhat. Suppose 1500 is the rated speed. So it may reduce 1490 or 1495 like that. Why? Because this Ra is very small, right? For change in Ia from no load to full load, the drop Ia Ra is very, very small. Ia Ra is very, very small means, hence the drop in speed is also very, very low change from no load to full load. So that the characteristics is slightly drooping, as shown in figure, slightly drooping. That's why DC shunt motor is a drooping characteristics. And last one, speed torque characteristics. These characteristics, like the speed versus torque, these characteristics can be derived from the above two characteristics. From these two characteristics, you can derive these characteristics. This graph is similar to speed armature current. As torque is proportional to the armature current, this curve shows that speed almost remains constant, though torque changes from no load to full load conditions. So this is nothing but, so speed torque characteristics of shunt motor is similar to the speed versus armature current. Next. Characteristics of DC series motor. We know that torque proportional to pi Ia, right? But In shunt motor, pi is constant. But series motor, pi directly proportional to Ia. Therefore, torque is proportional to pi Ia. Pi is nothing but Ia again. So, torque proportional to Ia square. So, torque proportional to Ia square. So, now it is looking as a like this. Square. So, current is, in case of series motor, series field winding is carrying entire armature current. Therefore, pi proportional to Ia. Therefore, torque proportional to Ia square. Thus, torque in case of series motor is proportional to the square of the armature current. And the relation is parabolic nature. Parabolic nature. So, because of torque proportional to Ia square, the series motor having high starting torque, and this type of motors can produce high torque for small amount of armature current. Hence, series motors are suitable for application which demand for high starting torque. So, and also another thing, because of high starting torque, the series motor does not start without a load. So otherwise, series motor does not start at no load condition. Always it will started with some load, some mechanical load. So next characteristics, speed armature current characteristics. So N proportional to EB by pi. EB means V minus IARA minus IARSE by pi is nothing but IAE. Now the values of Ra, Rsa are very small. That may affect the change in Ia on speed, overrides the effect of change in V minus IaRa minus IaRse. Hence, the speed equation Eb is approximately equal to terminal voltage. All are negligible. Eb is approximately equal to terminal voltage, and that is also terminal voltage is nothing but constant value. So speed equation reduced to N proportional to 1 by Ia. So like this. So N proportional to 1 by Ia. So this is a rectangular hyperbola. Torque versus current, parabolic nature. Speed versus armature current, rectangular hyperbola. And speed versus torque also. We know that torque proportional to Ia square. We know that N proportional to 1 by Ia. Therefore, N proportional to 1 by root T. As torque increases, when load increases, speed decreases. On no load, torque is very high, right? For series motor, high starting torque. So at no load, it is having high starting torque. And then as armature current increases, torque increases, that speed will be decreases. This is nothing but rectangular hyperbola. Suppose this is 2 marks question. Why series motor never started on no load? If it is started, so the armature or field may break. Why? Because it may attain very high speed, infinite speed. Because of that infinite speed, series motor winding may broke. That's why always series motor running with some load, not under no load condition. At no load condition, series motor does not work. Next, characteristics of compound motor. This is not that much of important. Only draw the characteristics of DC motor is nothing but shunt and series. Suppose you can see that compound motor also. Compound motor characteristic basically depends upon whether the motor is cumulative or differential. Cumulative motor is capable of developing large amount of torque because it aids the fluxes, shunt and series. Series winding takes care of the heavy load, whereas shunt winding prevents the motor from running at dangerously high speed. and the load is suddenly removed. But differentially compound motors, series flux opposes the shunt flux, then the total flux decreases with increasing load. Due to this, speed remains almost constant, even it may increase this slightly with increase in load. So look at the figures. Torque versus IA. For series motor, so it is a hyperbola. For shunt, it is a straight line. For cumulative, both are adding like this. For differential, both are difference below shunt motor. Speed versus IA. For shunt motor, it is a constant one. So it is a slightly reducing. For series motor, rectangular hyperbola. For cumulative, this one. For differential, this one. So speed versus IA and speed versus torque, both are same. Look at the applications of DC motors, very very important. Shunt motor means constant speed or adjustable speed or medium starting torque. Constant speed means all home auxiliaries, centrifugal pumps, machine tools, blowers, fans, reciprocating pumps, latches, all are utilized in shunt motors, DC shunt motor. Series motor means, so variable speed, high starting torque means traction work, locomotives, trucks, trolleys, cars, crane, hoists, conveyor belts, all are utilizing series motor. Cumulative compound motor. This is also similar to that of shunt and series, combination of shunt and series. Elevators, shears and punches, heavy planers, air compressors, like that. So many applications may be utilized in cumulative compound. But differentially compound, only arc welding. Differentially compound motor is used only in arc welding only. Generally, it is not suitable for practical applications, but only that application only we are utilizing differential compound. Cumulative compound is also utilized in cumulative compound is also utilized in rolling mills, elevators, heavy planners, like that, right? This is about today class. Next class we'll go for the another chapter. So till now discuss about the principle of operation of DC motor, back EMF, torque equation, and then characteristics of DC motors. Right? Any doubt, please ask me.